Okay, hello everybody. Thanks for joining my talk today. At first, let me take a photo of you so that I can prove to my wife and to my colleagues that a bunch of people is listening to me when I talk about OAuth 2. Thanks. Okay, the slides, please. Okay, perfect. My talk is titled with Understanding OAuth 2 for Real. My name is Johannes Pichler. I'm working as a lead web developer at Karriere.at, situated in Linz in Upper Austria. I'm a web dev since 2006, and I'm mostly into backend technologies like PHP and Java. Okay, my company, Karriere.at, is actually the biggest job platform in Austria. We have about 150 employees, and 40 of them are developers or are working in a development-related field. Okay, now some warnings at the beginning. This talk will cover a lot of opinions about OAuth 2. These are mine opinions. If you have another opinion, that's awesome. Okay, as you have already noticed, maybe I'm not a native speaker, so please be indulgent to me. I will do the best and I will try to speak as good as possible. Okay, start with confusion. I will cover a lot of topics in this talk because OAuth 2 is a very, very deep topic and it needs a lot of explaining. But at least for me, OAuth 2 or the server side of OAuth 2 was some kind of magic at the beginning before I start looking into it. Okay, now my story for today. About a year ago, my boss came to me and told me about a new application that we need to implement in our infrastructure. The problem was we have already two login mechanisms in our ecosystem, and this web application would use almost the same login mechanism as one other, but it with a slightly difference. So let's show this on a slide. Okay, basically everything at Karriere.at works with an API. We have a centralized API, and each application gets its data from there. And on the one hand, we have a B2C login for our users. They are using Karriere.at, and they can there upload their CV, do job applications, and also save their job searches and get email notifications when new jobs for the job search saved are available. And on the other hand, we have the so-called B2B login for our customers. There they have the opportunity to enter new job offers, to search for new applicants, and also to update and provide their employer content. Okay, now when we introduce a new application, we will have a third node on this graph, and it will use almost the same login as the B2B login, but there are additional flags to tell if the user is allowed or not allowed to enter the application. Now, how can OAuth 2 help us to solve this? At first, we have to define the standardized roles of OAuth 2, and then the API becomes our resource server. The authorization server is added, and the applications in the middle are renamed to clients. And the fourth and most important role is actually the user, the resource owner. Now that we have defined the roles, we can look at the definition. I will read it for you. The OAuth 2 authorization framework enables a third-party application to obtain limited access to an HTTP service either on behalf of a resource owner by orchestrating an approval interaction between the resource owner and the HTTP service, or by allowing the third-party application to obtain access on its own behalf. Basically, this means on the one hand, the resource owner, the user, has to approve the interaction between the client and the resource server. He has to allow the used scopes, or on the other hand, he grants the third-party application to use the resources the application needs to. Okay, now let's step into the most popular and most important grant type of OAuth 2, the authorization code grant. In fact, there is the client, the web application, and it serves some content to the to the user. I will link to the browser in this case. Now the user wants to log in into the application, and he sends his login request to the authorization server directly. The authorization server then checks if the user is already authenticated and authorized, and when it's not the case, the authorization server will redirect the user to a login page. He enters his credentials and then sends the login data back to the authorization server. There, the validation of the credentials is done, and then the nasty stuff is happening. You have seen this before when you are logging in with OAuth to Facebook. You get a dialogue, a prompt with different scopes that the application needs. Read the profile data, show my profile image, use my email address, and such stuff. Then the user has the opportunity or the possibility to check or uncheck the requested scopes and send back the information to the auth server. Now, the authorization server can complete the authorization code request and redirect back, send a redirect back to the browser with the callback URL that is defined for the client application. The browser, in fact, will follow this redirect, and then the client application can extract the auth code issued by the authorization server and can exchange this authorization code with an access token. Now, when the access token is valid in the client application, the client knows that the user is a valid user. He's authorized to access the protected resources and can then show him a login state or something else. Okay, that's the basic auth code flow. And now let's look into these steps in detail. The first step is the so-called authorize step, where you start off the authorization code flow by calling a GET request to an authorize endpoint with several parameters, a response type of code, then the client identifier for the client application, the requested scopes that the client application needs to read from the resource server, and the fourth parameter, a state parameter, that can be used to save a state to restore when the client application gets access back, or to validate that the authorization code flow was not intercepted by any attacker or something. Okay, the response will either be a direct callback to the client callback, or in our case, it will send a redirect to our login page. There, the user can, of course, enter his username and his password, click sign in, do this post request, and the data is validated on the server. And then the authorization server responds back with the actual callback URL, and you can see the code parameter attached. And this code parameter is then used by the client application to exchange the authorization code with an actual access token. In this case, the client application needs also to provide its client secret. It's very important that you keep the client secret private and do not make it publicly available, because with this secret key, everybody can request access tokens from the authorization server. And this response will actually make the client application happy, because it includes the access token that is used to access the protected resources on the resource server, and also a refresh token to refresh the authorization. Okay, now we have seen two tokens down there. Now let's look what these tokens are about. JOT. You may have heard about it, you may have not. Okay, I would say GWT, but the common sense is JOT, and JOT is a name for JSON Web Token. That's an open standard for securely transmitting data between two parties. The main features are the JOT token is compact, the content in it itself is very small and kept very minimal, and it's self-contained. That means that every information that is needed for someone else is stored inside of the token in a JSON format. And the use cases are, of course, authentication and information exchange in general. At least the format is consists of three parts that are separated by dots. The first part of the JOT token is the header information. It's a type field that tells us that it's a JWT token, and then an ELK field that tells us the algorithm that was used for signing the token. And in case of my OAuth server, it also provides the unique token identifier that is issued from the authorization server. The second part of the JWT token is the actual payload. This is all the information a client application and also a resource server needs to get information out and send back the correct data for the request. The first field is the audience. In our case, that's the client identifier that the JWT token is using. Then GTI is again the unique token identifier issued by the authorization server. The three timestamps, the first one is issued at, then not used before. We can issue JWT tokens that are used in the future, and an expiration timestamp. The subject field contains a user identifier, and the last field is scopes. These are the requested and authorized scopes to be used by the client application. Okay, now we come to the JWT signature. The two fields, the header and the payload, are base64 encoded, joined by a dot, and then an HMAC or RSR algorithm is applied on this string, and then these informations get concatenated. The header and payload, again, base64 encoded, and the signature in plain text at the end. Please make sure that you know that the header and the payload stored in the JWT token are readable data. So please skip every private data out from there, because everybody that can do a base64 decode and then some form of JSON representation can read this information. You should not store sensitive data or admin or other Boolean flags that are maybe dangerous for your application flow. Okay, now another problem. We have implemented an authorization code flow, or we have seen the authorization code flow, but the first thing that comes in mind for me is I'd like to identify a user. I'd like to present him your name, maybe his profile picture, and such things. And now we need to get the user's identity, the information about the user. Name, profile picture, as already said, and automated data like a birth date or something else. The first solution that comes in mind would be a profile endpoint on the resource server, and the client application uses the access token to request this information, but that's an additional call and slows down your application in some cases. But there is an extension to OAuth2 that's called OpenID Connect. OpenID Connect is an identity layer on top of OAuth2. You simply add an additional scope to your initial authorized request, and then an ID token is delivered with the access token response, as you can see in the response down there. The ID token is also a JWT token, and you can extract all relevant data from there. Okay, now that we have seen all the required steps, I will show you this with a short demo and application. It's a very simple application. You basically have only a login button. You click on login. In behind the authorize step is triggered with a response with a redirect to my login page. Then I enter my user information. Click on sign in. Then the post request is done to the server, and the post request responds with a redirect to the callback URL of the client application. The client exchanges the authorization code with an access token and a refresh token, and then redirects to the start page again. And you can see in the response the two tokens, and also my name and my profile picture that I extracted from the ID token. Okay. Now let's look at other grant types. The OAuth2 specification has several grant types defined in it, but I will only focus on the most popular and most common. The first one is the implicit grant. Instead of an authorization code, an access token is returned directly to the client. This means that when the user signs in successfully, the access token gets responded and the client application can use this directly. But the secret step from the client application to the authorization server is missing. So you shouldn't use this grant type anymore. And you should focus on using the auth code grant, either without the client secret or by including paycard CE. That's a proof key for code exchange. That's something similar to the client secret, but basically the client generates the secret code at the beginning, sends it to the authorization server, and on the last request, when the authorization code is exchanged with an access token, this secret gets validated, and only when this is valid, an access token is responded to the client. Then there is a password grant. This grant type can be used for first-party applications like internal services. You basically exchange a client ID, a username, and a password against an access token. And then the client credentials flow used for machine-to-machine communication, like in cron jobs or in service tasks that need no user information and need to do stuff on the protected resources. Therefore, you can use the client credentials grant. And you also exchange a client ID and the client secret against an access token. Important point, all these grant types do not include a refresh token. And this is our last grant type, the refresh token grant. When the access token expires, the client application is able to exchange the refresh token against the new access and the new refresh token. So the user doesn't have to log in again. Yeah, actually, it's used when the access token has expired. Okay, which grant type should I use for which type of application? The client credentials, of course, you should use for cron jobs and system tasks. The password flow for first-party applications like internal tools that do not go over the internet and are working in your private network. The authorization code flow for third-party apps, single-page applications, and native apps. The last two mentioned should always include the proof key for code exchange flow to make them secure, and the implicit grant almost never. Okay, now let's come to the next important point, access token validation. The resource server needs some way to validate if the token has expired, if the given signature matches the actual payload and header information stored inside the token so that we can validate that no attacker was in between and manipulated token information. This is done on the resource server, and in many documentations of popular OAuth2 frameworks, there is mentioned that, of course, you can validate the expiration date by opening the JWT token, extracting the information, and check the date. But what about signature validation? The signature is calculated with either a secret or a public-private key pair, and this information is mostly not known to the resource server. So the resource server has to know the public key to directly validate if the token signature matches the content of the token. But there is another specification called token introspection. This specification defines a method for a protected resource to query an OAuth2 authorization server to determine the active state of an OAuth2 token and to determine meta information about this token. OAuth2 deployments can use this method to convey information about the authorization context of the token from the authorization server to the protected resource. Okay, this in fact means you send the token and the authorization server responds if the token is active or not, and also provides you with the meta information stored inside of the token. Basically, it's an additional post endpoint on the authorization server that provides the information inside the token as plain JSON, which is good because you don't have to do the extraction manually, and it tells if a token is valid or not. The response for an invalid token will actually be a JSON object with active false, and for a valid token, it will tell active true, the token type, the scopes, and all the information stored inside the token. So this is a good way to outsource the introspection point to the authorization server and don't redo this in every single resource server that you implement. Now we come to implementing an OAuth2 server. The first question that may arise is, why should I implement my own solution? There are SaaS solutions out there like OAuth.io or OAuth0.com, which have several advantages, but also disadvantages, of course. Advantage would be someone else is responsible for implementing and managing the OAuth stuff. It's easy to use and implement in your client applications. If you looked at the OAuth.io implementation, it's about 5 lines of JavaScript code to keep going, to get going with OAuth2. But the downsides of this approach, you have to transfer your user data to the cloud, to these cloud providers, and the whole authorization and authentication procedure is outsourced. If you need something a little different from the standard flow, you have a problem to implement this. So for us, the outsourcing was not an option. When I'm able and when I'm decided to implement my own OAuth2 server, I can use mature frameworks. In PHP, we have the OAuth2 server by the PHP League. In Node.js, we have Node OAuth2 server by OAuth.js. And in Java, of course, we have Spring Security OAuth2. All of these frameworks work mostly the same. The standard OAuth code flow is handled by the framework, and you only have to tell which repositories and which models are used for accessing the data, like user information, the scopes, the access token, and all this stuff. Okay, now let's look at an implementation which I've done in PHP by using the Slim framework. Slim framework is a lightweight framework for APIs, and of course the OAuth package by the League of Extraordinary Packages. Oh. I think I skipped the database part of my demonstration because SQL Pro is so small, the font size is so small. Okay, now let's look at the first actual endpoint, the authorize step. You have the method called authorize that is called by the controller, by the router. This is the controller function. You get in the request and the response. And the only thing you have to do, you have to call validate authorization request on the authorization server instance. Then you have to store the auth request somewhere in the session. And then you can respond with a redirect to the login page. It's a very simple example. We only assume that the user is not logged in and directly send back a login form. And of course, there can arise some exceptions, an OAuth server exception and a general exception that needs to be handled also. The login handler is actually very simple. Respond with login form. This is something custom implemented by myself, which only displays the HTML form. And then the actual post request with the login data. We have to extract the username and the password from the form params. Then we can use the defined user repository to get the user entity by the credentials entered. If we get a valid user from the database, we can use the session repository to restore the auth code request that was started in the request before. And we can set the user on the auth code request and set the authorization to approved. And then we can call the authorization server again and tell him to complete the authorization request. And this method will bring back a redirect to the client, to the browser with the redirect URL from the client application. Maybe another important part is the repository implementation. Repositories are defined by interfaces by the package. As an example, we look at the access token repository interface. It needs a method to get a new token for a client and for the defined scopes. We need a method for persisting a new access token because in the OAuth flow, we can at any time, we can revoke an issued access token and the user should not have access anymore to the protected resources. This is done with the revoke access token method. And of course, a check if an actual access token is already revoked. The user repository is almost the same. We have the method get user entity by user credentials. This is used on the login step. That's the only method that is required to get the user. Refresh token repository and off-code repository are the same, or almost the same as the access token repository. You need to issue a new token. You need to revoke a token. You need to check if a token was already revoked. And the last repository that is interesting is the client repository. Of course, you need to get a client at an entity with the client identifier and the actual grant type, and then you can validate if the current authorization code flow is actually started with the correct client and also ended with the correct client. Yeah. Okay, now I'm... Okay, and the last controller that is implemented by myself is the token handler. This is responsible for access token and refresh token issuing. Okay, the only thing we need to do is call the authorization server method, respond to access token request, and give it the request and the response object passed in from the router, and the authorization server, the framework, will respond to the request. As you can see, the implementation is very, very minimal. Most of the OAuth stuff is done by the framework itself. You only have to enable the required grant types. You have to tell which repositories and which entities you implement. You have to connect to the actual data source, and then everything is working out already. Okay. Now let's get back to my presentation. Now let's summarize what I've talked about in the last 30 minutes. OAuth2 is a good standard for implementing an authorization system. I've skipped the authentication system here because the standard explicitly tells you that it's an authorization system, not an authentication system. But this doesn't work out for me because when you use a password flow, you get in a password and an username, and you need to validate this data, and then it's not an authorization system, it is an authorization plus an authentication system. OAuth2 has many different grant types for different use cases, which actually very, very good. But it needs to be combined with an authentication mechanism. And it defines squishy boundaries that you need to be explicit about. The specification is very loosely coupled. You have the freedom to do everything you want, basically. And when you look at OAuth implementations by Facebook from GitHub, they are all slightly different. Token introspection is not done by them at all. They have a me endpoint to get the user information from a token, and that's always another response structure than the introspection specification tells. Okay, and OAuth2 can help us, in my case, my company, to centralize the auth system for my organization, because I can implement different grant types on my authorization server, and I can use native apps, web applications, and all kind of stuff to authorize against a single point in my system and can keep this centralized. Okay, now some interesting resources when you want to start implementing OAuth or if you are interested in general. There's the OAuth.net website, which has a list of all relevant specifications that are involved in OAuth2. Then OAuth.com, which is a human-readable version of the specification. There I got most of the information for my talk because the RFCs are hard to read, almost for me. And a very good book by Justin Richer and Antonio Sanso, called OAuth 2 in Action. Justin Richer is involved in the committee that brought up the specification for OAuth 2. So he's a guy that knows very well what he's doing and what he's talking about. And of course, in a few days, I will release a bunch of blog articles about OAuth 2 and implementing it in PHP on my personal blog. Okay, thanks for listening. I hope you got some information about OAuth 2 and it was already rather slightly useful for you. Thanks.
Fantastic. That's excellent. And this guy apologizes for his English. Can we have another round of applause for his English? Okay. We're almost running out of time. We have a few questions, and there are a couple of good ones. So if we could get them up on the screen, then look at this. There's the third one I want to answer first, because this question came in 5 minutes into your talk. You hadn't even started, and someone said, can they get the slides? Can they
okay.
get the slides?
Yes, I will upload them to my website, and we'll share it on Facebook on the Vue Developers page.
Okay, now let's look at the microservices one. What okay. do you say?
Yeah. Yeah, microservices is a difficult topic. It either depends. If it's an internal service, the microservices are only talking to each other internally, you can use the machine-to-machine communication with the client credentials grant. Or if you're using it from the user side or from a web application, you need to do the authorization code flow. Otherwise, it wouldn't be secure enough.
Okay, whoever asked that, and the 25 people who upvoted it. Remember, you can upvote any questions that are on the in the app. Okay, number two, if you're a back-end user, what about this with a native login?
If you're back-end user,
is it clear?
Yeah, basically, that's, you need to remove the native login from your application and store the authentication step on your authorization server. So the user triggers the login procedure, gets to the authorization server, and then the authorization server redirects you to a login form to enter the credentials. Otherwise, an attacker would be able to intercept the request and manipulate the data.
Does that make sense? Say yes. Good, because we need to move on. Time is very tight. Sorry about that. Okay, let's do a couple more. Ways to protect the client's secret in apps.
He laughs. Is this meant in native applications or in SPAs? SPAs, okay. I've told about the proof key for code exchange. This is an extension or two of two. You basically generate the client secret in the SPA, send it to the authorization server, have to do a code challenge, and then when exchanging the auth code with the access token, you need to send the identical secret again so that the authorization server can ensure that the request was sent from the same source that it was started from. Maybe I will upload a blog post about this too, because that's a very difficult topic. And you read about SPAs on the internet that you should use the implicit flow, and this is not good at all.
That's good. Just Google Johannes Pichle. He's out there on the interwebs that they have these days. Couple more. Any known attacks against OAuth 2? It's been around for so long.
Yeah, the main attacking point is to steal an authorization code, of course, because you can implement the auth code flow without the client secret, and then this is relevant because when you can steal an authorization code, you can exchange this authorization code only with the client identifier to get an actual access token, and this is problematic.
Right, a couple more, and then it's lunchtime. What about the HTTP? Was that just an example in your slide, or do you have to use?
That was only an example. You should use TLS for your authentication process, of course.
You have to answer the next one. Come on. If it gets upvoted 12 times, somebody has to
ask. Yes, it was my favorite drink, but not anymore.
Okay, Okay, at a time, just one which was further down, didn't get upvoted, but I want to hear it. Have you really worked at this company for 12 years? Did you start when you were 16?
No, I've not worked at this company for 12 years. I've started in Vienna at the company, at a development company, and then moved to Linz, and I'm at Coyote for about 2 years now.
He's the man. Let's say thank you very... There it is. That's the question. Thanks very much to Johannes Michler. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot again.
Thanks for listening.